the whole experience, yeah. But also allows you to...
So it's 50 million a day?
Yeah.
And the average price of an ad is what? How much do you get for an ad?
Well...
Come on. No. 10 cents per thousand.
It can be. It can be. It depends. Because Blackberry is very, very tough on the market.
Okay.
Market side of things. Because no one wants to advertise on Blackberry. So from time to time, you get a huge spike.
Yeah.
Where some church or someone just throws a lot of money in there. And for a couple of days, there are a lot of ad requests. And then it goes down. A lot of ad impressions, ad fills on all requests. And then it goes down as well.
Okay, so let's move into the you've then transitioned. The world now is connecting apps to things, right? You can control, Google buys Nest because you can control your aircon or your remote, right? And you've got, you know, watches, smartwatches kind of telling you what's going on with your body. You've got cars that will probably be remote racing. So in the fridges. So how does that, tell us about how you see that working, the kind of the idea of an app suddenly making the Internet of Things more interesting. Because I've heard a lot of talk over the years about the Internet of Things, right?
Yeah.
And the problem is, to the average Joe, the idea of connecting things has absolutely no meaning. But along comes an app, and it's taken, what, 5 to 8 years for the average consumer to go, ooh, that's an app, and that's how it works. So how does this transition from an app to like droids or fridges or?
So the term Internet of Things is very interesting. It's kind of similar to what people were talking about NFC 5 years ago, and it was supposed to be a big thing.
Yeah, PCCW go NFC 5 years ago.
Used to be, right? Yes, it's getting better and better, yeah. Right? And more people kind of get it. What it can do, but the actual implementation is kind of not really lacking, but it's very slow. And the Internet of Things as connecting all these kinds of devices that are going on with each other is a very, you know, abstract way of describing what happened.
Let's ask the PR guy. How would you describe the Internet of Things?
It's your phone connected to your car, your scales in your bathroom, maybe something else, your stereo, your TV. Is that a good start?
Yeah, something like that. There are some research studies that suggest that by 2020 we will have about 50 billion devices that will be connected to each other, to transmit data between each other. So you have your fridge knowing what's inside the fridge, and maybe
Fridge knowing what's inside the fridge is not interesting until you have an app, right?
Not necessarily.
I mean, how many people stand in front of their fridge going, what's inside the fridge?
No, but
and most people open it and go, oh, right? Whereas if you're in your office, you go, what's inside my fridge? You either got a webcam inside your fridge, in which case you're a sad bastard. Or, you know, so you need a remote. The remoteness is what makes it interesting, right?
Yeah.
I mean, the idea of having, I always said this idea of having screens on the front of your fridge telling you the milk is off is fucking stupid, because you just open it and go, oh, close it again, right?
Exactly, but that's not the connected part. The connected part is where the fridge actually tells Park & Shop to deliver a new milk tomorrow because you're about to run out.
Yeah.
Right?
So what you're saying is, in effect, the Internet of Things is removing the human being out of the equation. In your case, the one
you yes. So there can be many other things that are connected, like you mentioned cars. You could theoretically have each and every car connected to the cloud, know where they are in case an accident happens on your road or something. You would at least know where the last known location is, and you can kind of narrow the search of, you know, finding a person that had an accident, for example.
How can you find cars if you can't even find aeroplanes?
That's a very good
question. There you go. So I'm curious. So tell us, I want to transition from an app to you know, connected to a robot or a machine, right? So you I've been to your office, and you not only do you have 3D printers, and it's kind of like going into some weird sci-fi thing, but you're also making droids, right? Have you been sponsored by the Israeli government, or no? Not yet.
Not yet. Actually, the Israelis were the first ones that built an autonomously flying military-grade drone.
I'm not surprised.
We kind of branched out into the drone business about 2 years ago.
Were you very drunk one night? You said, "What I need is a drone." How do you go from apps into drones? I can't see the transition.
We had this idea for a couple of years before, but by the time components got really cheap and it was affordable to actually buy a drone or build a drone yourself, we could buy the components and then actually build one, fly, and experiment with it. So 2 years ago, we started building our first drones, trying to experiment with how it works. Trying to fly, crash some, lost some.
Where do you fly a drone in Hong Kong? That doesn't get you in trouble.
We flew on Lama in the power station. No, it was an open field area, and we tested our autopilot. It didn't work because it just took off and. It took like 5 seconds, it was gone. It was just flying towards the ocean and then it was gone. It crashed somewhere. That happens. But there are other places in Hong Kong where you can't fly, where there's no restricted area with the airplanes and stuff. But it's of course very, very limited in that space. There are some airfields even of model aircraft
flying. Yeah, I know if you go to Saigon, there's that beach, right, where all the model aircraft are doing their stuff, right? So do you say...
There are some areas in Saigon where it's allowed. There's some areas in Yuen Long area and
Nansan line. So when you made your drone, how do you connect... Actually, you made the camera, right?
Yeah, so our initial plan was to build like a full-blown drone and remotely control it from your phone. Very simple.
From your Blackberry.
Blackberry and and Windows code. So it was a very simple idea, very extremely hard to implement. So we kind of narrowed it down to create a data transmission system that can transmit data from the phone to the drone in real time over virtually unlimited range. So we use the mobile phone networks for that. And the first application that we put on top of that was video transmission, real-time, full HD, digital video.
I know the bandwidth doesn't get squeezed by the telco once they discover that you're using this kind of...
Well, you know, Hong Kong prides itself on having the fastest mobile phone here. While we don't use CSL, we're supposed to have the fastest one. We use Smarto 14 network, it's totally fine. If we fly long range, we were transmitting data from your long area to our Xiamen office in real time, and it was fine. There's no glitch or anything.
Because they use drones at the World Cup, didn't they? Were they using drones, or was it just fancy cameras on? I thought they had drones.
I don't. Maybe they have some, but I think maybe they just run some wires and they just try it.
So basically there's an app that supports the idea of connecting it to a drone.
Exactly.
So you went with crowdsourced, did you go to Kickstarter, or how did you get money to make this?
So 2 years ago we started, and then about a year ago we figured, oh, it's really going to take a long time to build the whole drone thing. So we focused on the camera thing, and then, because it wasn't exactly what we wanted, we had to do something with it, and we needed to generate some revenue and, you know, pay for the development. So therefore we went into crowdfunding. We looked at Kickstarter, the most obvious one. It's pretty much impossible if you're from Hong Kong or the United.
Why?
Because you have to be an American citizen to run a campaign in US dollars. You can't be British.
Yeah. Or actually Indiegogo as well, right? Indiegogo.
So we went for Indiegogo, the second largest one here. Which worked out okay. We wanted to get $80,000 in funding for the project. We did not reach the funding goal. So therefore everyone got their money back, didn't get any. But we got all the contacts of all the people that backed us. So
by the time, in fact, it was like a marketing vehicle. You didn't get the money, but you got the clients.
Yes. So we got the clients, and then once the campaign was over, we set up a pre-order sort of website and told everyone, okay, look, the campaign was successful, but we're still going to do it. We would like you to back us and pre-order now for the same price. And we could convert a lot of people to actually join for that. There's a couple of really, people from really big companies in there that supported us, so that helped a lot in kind of like getting a bit of traction, getting a bit of media coverage, TV or Bloomberg, for example.
Why would they cover what you were doing? Was it because the companies were buying?
Well, the TPP was doing a drone report on drones in March. So then they asked us. It's not many.
Are there many drone developers in Hong Kong?
No, it's not many.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of drone parts sellers in Hong Kong. There's lots of electronics. And then Bloomberg had a feature on startups. And then they went to talk to us and put us in the Bloomberg first night.
Right, cool.
7 a.m.
So where do you see this all going? If you have apps, you have machines that connect to apps, where is this moving towards? If you were looking ahead and going, right, if I want to invest in something new, do you think it's still more important, because some of the guys didn't get, is it more important to develop apps for consumers, or for businesses, or for advertisers, or for, yourself, where would you, governments, warfare, where is, actually the way the world's going at the moment, probably warfare, but where would you develop, where do you see this all going, right?
It's called defense
systems, warfare. Yeah.
The whole defense systems, governments, corporates and companies as well, very much depends on that. If you know people, if you're well connected into these companies, then you can sell them to them. But if you're not, I'm not, then it's really hard to do that. So therefore for us, we mainly focus on consumer-grade products. That includes the drone thing, that includes the city guys and our whole applications business. Because that allows us to add some scale without having any,
Yeah, but all these people now, there's wearable technology, right?
Yeah.
So would you start developing apps for, I don't know, smartwatches or fuel bands or whatever?
Yes.
Is that something that's worth developing an app for?
I think,
or are you still going to stay on the smartphone space or the tablet space?
No, I think it's moving more towards, these connected devices like watches.
Yeah.
These kinds of things. But right now the market is really small for that. So from a commercialization point of view, might not be worth it yet. And the whole technology area in these fields is not very mature.
So you wouldn't develop Google Glass apps, for example?
Well, yeah, we would experiment with it.
Yeah.
We would get one and then just try it.
Have you tried developing for Google Glass?
No, but...
You don't control your drone, the way you move your head around?
We do, but not the Google Glass. We use the virtual reality classes, because Google Glass is an augmented reality.
Yeah.
And we use virtual reality classes just completely covered. It's called Oculus.
That's what it's for.
Yeah, it was acquired by Facebook.
Yeah.
For $2 billion, company that was making money. So
they want you to have 3D Facebook.
It's actually pretty cool.
Fucking scary, is that?
3D we have this Oculus Rift developer set, and we connected it to our camera technology, so we can remote control the camera on a so-called gimbal that kind of can move the camera. So you can move your head and the camera will move at the same time. And you can move left and right and the camera moves.
Real time or is there a delay?
Real time. This is a slight delay, like maybe don't know, like 100 milliseconds, 150 milliseconds, something like that. But basically, that's the idea. Just imagine you fly a drone from here to Shenzhen, and you're there, and you want to check out like some building or whatever. And you're hovering there, but your camera's looking forward, and you want to just look down. You can't just put the drone down and crash, yeah. Right? So you took your hand and just looked down. You took left and right, and the camera moves, but the drone stays. So it helps a lot for use cases where you want to do, say, surveillance.
You should offer this to the Chinese government to survey Hong Kong in its democracy. July the 1st democracy protests, right?
In fact,
they're out loud and they cameras catch us all.
In fact, in Poland, they used drones in a demonstration, but it was not used by the police. It was used by the demonstrators to record
the police.
You know, to actually record what they do wrong. You know, whether they use people and such things.
Interesting. So let's take some questions from the floor. Everybody got any questions? There you go. This is long enough, so I'll let you take them.
Hi, Patrick. I have a question about marketing and promotion in general. So it's difficult to make a good app, but it's more difficult to get noticed. And for my background is in games, and for games or for apps in general, you have to climb up to the charts, top 10, top 20 to get noticed. Well, can you share your experience on how do you promote sometimes on low budget or no budget?
So what we do for many years now, and I study computer science. I'm not a marketer or anything.
I can tell that from your sandals.
Yes.
I would glad if you were still wearing sandals.
I would have put on some long pants, told you earlier. So it took me like a couple of years to actually believe that we had to do marketing for our products.
I thought technology just sells itself, right?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
That's what Silicon Valley tells you.
Yeah, when you're studying computer science, you think you create something awesome and just keep coming through anything. So that doesn't work. So you have to market it. So when we started off, they were not like social media networks were not that big yet, and it was not that easy to integrate into them. So we started off with a newsletter mailing list, just very simple. Still today, it's a very effective way of marketing. Very cheap.
You ask everybody who downloads your app for their email address?
Yeah, so what we did inside the app is, the first time you start the app, you get a small pop-up dialog that says, do you want to subscribe to free update information?
Okay.
Right? And we integrated it into the whole phone so that your email address and everything is like pre-filled. And you just have to press yes. And that's it. You don't have to enter anything. You have to make it as simple as possible, and when you do that, people actually join. They actually want to
subscribe. That's a good point, so it's a very simple opt-in.
It has to be simple. As soon as you have to enter something or select something, typing on Google, people just cancel. So you have to make it really simple. That's the one thing. So newsletters, we do that. Second thing is, we have a Facebook fan page, so 130,000 fans. So we did some promotions there, doing some giveaways, some sweepstakes, giving people like a free phone if they sign up, sort of thing, like doing sweepstakes, not everyone has a phone. That helped like raising the number of fans. We have Twitter that works okay. Over the years, we established a lot of contacts in the media field that is very specific to us. So blogs.
PR works. How about search? You haven't mentioned search. I'm quite surprised that you hadn't said search first.
In an App Store search.
App Store search, third-party app aggregators, Google, whatever. I mean, isn't that... Is search not a good tool for
the thing is, the only thing where you can search-wise optimize is inside this, the application store. Because you have to get people at the point where they want to have an app, they look for an app, and that's where you can, you know, try to optimize to have high ranks. So App Store optimization is a very big part, and obviously
to describe App Store, what exactly is App Store optimization? Does it mean sending $10 to the editor every month? What does App Store optimization mean? Is it describe the product? What is
the problem is, like, it's named the product. You have to have a name that is likely to be found. With games, that's really hard because it's usually something abstract. Then you have keywords in most stores that you can have. You have short descriptions that get syndicated, so you can use the right short description to rank higher. But you can also have applications that kind of match what people want. So with the city guides, for example, the whole idea is more about SEO optimization. Because when you want to go somewhere to a certain city, you can go onto the App Store and you search for city guides or some travel guides or something, find the 100 results, right? Don't know which one to use. Or you search for Albuquerque, you know, and you find our city guide, you know?
That's like a scattergun approach, right? Just get everywhere. So tell us, a lot of people who have as many apps as you do cross-advertising, right? You'll open the app and it'll say, if you like Albuquerque, you're also going to like Winnipeg. So do you use your own apps to promote other apps?
Yes, that's very important.
And is that effective?
It is, because it's just the same thing as in all kinds of sales and marketing areas, that it's much, much easier to convince a person than you convinced before, that already uses that. It's much easier to convince them to follow up, like on upselling them onto a separate application, whether it's paid or free, isn't it?
So I want to ask you as a follow up, do you believe in a freemium model? Have you done the freemium ones? These are all paid, right?
These ones are paid. We have freemium.
And it's the idea of offering something free and then, you know, bombarding people with advertising until they get so annoyed they pay for it. Is that the way to do it? Or is it free as in, you know, a certain amount of content is free and then you want to use it deeper, you pay?
There's no one answer to that. It really very much depends on your product. So we have this battery application that I mentioned before.
What's it called?
It's called Battery Watch.
Battery Watch. That's Android.
For Android. Right now, the latest version is available for Android. There's some really super old version for iOS, which I not recommend to download.
You're obviously an engineer. You're not recommending your own product. That's
well, it's not. It has to be updated soon. And there's a better version too. But that one, for example, the initial one had money advertising in there. So the good thing with advertising is, even if you don't get advertising fills from advertisers, you can actually fill these spots with your own ads, right? So you can cross-advertise a lot of your own products. That's good. But you need to have like a couple more, you can have different products.
So have you tried Facebook's? Facebook made a lot of money, or still is making a lot of money, from their mobile application ads, right?
Yes.
Have you tried that?
Yes.
And is that effective? Is that
I have looked at it.
Okay.
Because
Have you tried the mobile Facebook ads? Are they good?
Yeah, I think they have quite good targeting. You can target deeper to people's interests, what kind of features people have. So that's something quite unique.
That's true. We have a lot of targeting options. The only problem what I have with that is it's just too expensive. Even though they're priced quite low compared to others, for us it's still too expensive. So I have looked at it, I wanted to run it, but didn't do it in the end because it was too expensive. So we use other companies that provide
cheap. So what was the other question? There's one over here. Radio Chinwag, a little plug for Radio Chinwag, who were recording this. If you didn't catch what we said tonight, or if you have other people who want to listen to it, it's on SoundCloud. Go to SoundCloud, right? Web Wednesday on SoundCloud. So, Radio Tune Wang, tell us.
This is on behalf of me rather than Radio Tune Wang. I'm old, and when Napoleon was talking about opening his fridge door and smelling the milk, it resonates with me. I use apps. I probably use three apps. One is to check the Hong Kong Observatory when there's a typhoon coming. The second is to look at the air quality in Hong Kong. And the third is to check my Facebook. I don't use anything else because nobody has persuaded me that it's actually better to have an app than to open the fridge door and smell the milk. How are you going to, when all these people who use apps because they're young and they build up, blah, 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 how are you going to persuade somebody like me that it's worthwhile downloading an app to do something that I'm so accustomed to doing now? Old. Old. Is it a question?
That's a very good question.
He's an engineer, he's going to answer that one. That is a good question.
We bombard you.
So the question is, yeah, how do you persuade an old person to open an app? Is that a good question?
Yes. It's hard because it has to be obviously an application that...
What is the number? Isn't there some really weird number like everybody downloads like 90 apps and they only use 7 or something like that? Isn't there some proportion is ridiculous?
I don't know.
I'm guilty of that. I have about 400 apps and I use about 6.
Yeah, me too.
So how many people in this room have more than 100 apps on their phones? More than 200 apps? No? 3?
No, we counted them up before. I have between 30 and 50.
You know, I accidentally installed like 1,000 city guides on my phone once because
But when you go on the trip, how do you check, like, you know, do you go, you're not in Hong Kong anymore? Because what you mentioned was observatory, Hong Kong pollution, and Facebook. So when you go on a trip, do you not use your phone to find out TripAdvisor or Kayak or Uber or whatever? You not go, I wonder what if I get a taxi home or no?
No, I put my hand out and call one.
You really are old fashioned.
All right, no, but I mean, ask the concierge to do it for me. I don't know, I wouldn't do that.
I use Google Maps, yes.
The answer to your question is he's not bothering people. You're a loser.
I'm just
lost cause.
Right? I'm beyond redemption.
Yeah.
Okay, fair enough.
But there are, what's happening now, I know in the mobile industry, you've got certain companies that are doing, it's called TapJoy. You know TapJoy?
Yes, we use them.
And what they do is when you've got, they sniff your phone and they see if you've got other apps, they tell you, they remind you on your Facebook that actually you've got this other app, maybe you should open it a little bit more often. Right? So they're cross kind of promoting. So maybe you want the London Observatory or whatever it is.
TapJoy is also one of the companies that offer the lowest paid app installations. So if you want to look for, you know, getting installations of the app, you're willing to pay for it, they offer one of the lowest prices for certain areas.
So okay, any one last question? Any questions? Anyone? All right, well, thanks for hanging around. You can hang around for another hour. A round of applause for our impromptu speaker. Patrick came tonight because I wasn't going to have Pat on the apps and we ran out of contestants, so Patrick volunteered. So he should deserve an extra special round of applause. And also, if you're interested in, you know, what's happening in the kind of technology entrepreneurial sphere in Hong Kong, Patrick's covering quite a lot of spots. He's got a mobile, he's got 3D printing. You should go to his office, he's printing all kinds of weird things. 3D printers, droids, what else have you got? Free desks, rent out desks.
We do, we have space, yeah.
So, what I like about Hong Kong, you'll find entrepreneurs who are doing different things, right? They'll move on to the next thing, try it out. So, thanks for coming, it's a smaller crowd. We'll put this up on SoundCloud, but do hang around and chat a little bit. Get to know each other. PCCW, Carson, and a few new faces from America. Where did you come from?
Oh, from the States.
From the States, where?
From New Jersey.
New Jersey, there we go. So if you want to hang around the States, talk to this lovely lady. Okay, so thanks a lot. And Bronnie is going to put some photos up, so you'll see yourselves. And there won't be selfies, these are actually quite nice. photographs, haven't you? So I'll put them up on Facebook later. I've got some news for you. Next Wednesday, I have Uber. So Uber has just launched in Hong Kong. So we're going to do an interview with the head of Uber Hong Kong. So who's used Uber? Yeah, the Americans have, right? Who else has used Uber? Where? Hong Kong. Hong Kong. Was it a good experience?
Yeah, it's pretty fast. It took 5 minutes.